It is a, what's the word I'm looking for? It is a, having a moment.
What does a turbocharger do?
Turbocharger compresses air.
It takes the hot expanding gases from your exhaust.
It's exhaust gas driven.
Spins up a turbine, which drives a shaft, spins up another turbine.
Just forces air in using the exhaust gases.
It takes this nice, cold, fresh air and compresses it and jams it into your engine.
More power, baby.
Yeah, a turbo is basically a giant air compressor. Not giant, it's just an air compressor.
Another oversimplification, but yes, perfect.
It's a replacement for displacement.
Oh boy.
The classic, there's no replacement for displacement except unless you supercharge it or turbocharge it.
And creating more power.
Why is an intercooler important on a turbocharged car?
When you compress air, that air gets hot.
I don't have the full technical answer to this, Kyle, so I'm gonna defer to you.
And in order to cool those things down, you need something similar to a radiator, which is an intercooler.
Mother lover, okay.
Hot air is less dense and it's power robbing.
It's trying to get some of that heat out of that pressurized air.
So what you'd wanna do is after you've compressed the air is to cool down a little bit so that you're not losing power.
Power, power, power.
Why do people tune turbocharged cars?
It's pretty self-explanatory.
Yeah, next question.
Yeah.
More power, more
power
boost, bro.
Power corrupts.
Well, because from factory, they come very limited.
No, power doesn't corrupt in
power
vehicle.
Corrupts.
So a really easy way to make more power in a turbo car.
Unless you don't know how to handle it, then you
power
corrupt a guardrail.
Creating more pressure and building more boost.
You add more boost.
You got more power.
You got more power.
Vroom, vroom.
The computer is what controls the wastegate.
You can augment, you know, timing settings.
The wastegate is what controls the turbo.
How much fuel you're dumping into a car based on what kind of turbo you're running.
That said computer, tuning it, you can actually up the boost pressure significantly.
Sometimes you can tune for more efficiency, but most people tune for power.
And that will create significant power.
Power, power, power.
Do I want a smaller or larger turbo?
You want the biggest boosty boy you can get.
Beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
Lies in your heart.
It's not what you should use, it's really what you want to do.
Smaller turbos are, they spool faster, which means you have better throttle response.
Have less lag.
The bigger the turbo, the bigger the lag.
Smaller turbos are going to be more responsive generally.
If you're looking for all-out horsepower, bigger turbo is your way to go.
It depends on your end goal.
If you actually want drivability, throttle response, not a huge amount of turbo lag, somewhere in the middle is the way to go.
If you're looking for like straight up dyno clean power, you want the biggest turbo you can get.
I fall in the hybrid turbo range, which kind of gives me the best of both worlds.
Power and how long it takes to spool are the main things you have to be looking at.
I don't have a ton of lag, but I don't have the crazy top end that a drag car may have.
Power, power, power.
What is turbo lag?
It's literally waiting for something awesome to happen.
The exact reason why I hate turbocharged cars.
You put your foot down and you wait and you wait and you wait.
It's just waiting for the power to kick in.
Turbo lag is essentially how long it takes a turbo to spool up and create full boost.
Yeah, the delay that happens when your turbocharger is trying to build boost, but it hasn't yet.
With a big turbo, you're probably gonna have turbo lag because it takes a lot of pressure to get that thing going.
The more time that takes, the more turbo lag you have.
Yeah. A tiny turbo doesn't take a lot and it'll just...
What am I doing here? Why is nothing happening?
Power, power.
What's the difference between a single turbo, a twin turbo, and a twin scroll turbo?
They're variations of turbochargers.
It's all gonna be responsiveness.
You have your single turbo, which is you're gonna have one singular, you know, exhaust turbine and one singular intake turbine.
Listen, twin scroll has two inlet ports on the turbine housing.
At low RPM, it uses one, so it can spool up the turbo quicker, and at high RPM, it uses another, so it doesn't overspool the turbo.
Goldilocks and the three bears. You know, it's like the best of both worlds.
And then a twin turbo is basically just two complete turbochargers bolted next to each other.
Power, power, power.
What is a turbo timer?
Essentially, a turbo timer keeps the engine running.
A turbo timer is essentially turbo protection.
So that oil continues to pass through and coolant continues to pass through the turbo.
It's like a safe gate, essentially, so that your turbo doesn't just shut off with nothing running through it.
So that the turbo can cool down.
If you were to shut your car off, the coolant and oil and possibly coolant that's flowing through it would stop flowing.
The worst thing that you can do is get a turbocharger extremely hot and then turn it off without doing a cool down of some sort.
Whereas if you have a turbo timer, it allows that stuff to continuously pass through it, kind of pull some of the heat away from it so you don't have that one turbocharger heat soaking and possibly getting damaged.
Why should you turn start-stop off with a turbocharged car?
There are many reasons you should turn start-stop functions off.
For the same reason you put a turbo timer in the car.
Primarily is freaking bearing wear. I'm not even worried about the turbo at that point.
You're gonna be cycling the engine tons of times, which also means you'll be cycling the turbocharger.
When you come to a stop and your engine shuts off, it stops pumping coolant and oil through that turbo.
It's just another way to get dealers to make you buy a starter sooner than later.
Yeah, oftentimes manufacturers, they think of these things beforehand.
Most of these modern cars do have an electric water pump that continues to pass coolant through the turbo.
The amount of trees that you're gonna save by having your car not running at idle will be offset by the amount of turbos you have to replace in your car.
That's true.
Listen, starters, engine mounts, don't worry about the turbo, worry about the rest of the engine.
Unless you live in LA and you're gonna sit in traffic for half an hour at a time without moving,
yeah,
you shouldn't use start-stop.
Even at idle, just keep that stuff flowing through there. It's gonna pull that heat out, pass it through the radiators, it's gonna cool it down.
What is the difference between a blow-off valve and a diverter valve?
One blocks and one diverts.
Next question.
Yes.
Well, the blow-off valve makes the loud choo-choo noise, and the diverter valve is kind of like a less of a choo-choo noise.
They're pretty much the same thing, honestly.
So they're getting rid of, you know, excess boost pressure.
When your turbo is spooling up and building a lot of boost and your intake charge is filled with more than atmospheric pressure,
your blow-off valve is venting directly to the atmosphere.
So rather than blowing your throttle plate into the engine and blowing up things,
diverter valve is recirculating that bled boost back into the intake circuit.
Blow-off valves are generally not recommended to be used on cars with mass airflow sensors because it makes the mass airflow sensor freak the out.
Do it again, that high-pitched noise.
Pew!
There you go, yeah. That noise.
You like that?
Pew!
Yeah.
I heard you in the dorm shower once. You were making high-pitched noises. What's up with that?
That was something different.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yo, edit that out. Okay.
What's up, YouTube? Do you have questions about your car that you're a little embarrassed to ask? Leave them in the comments below, and we'll address them in a future episode. I'm just doing what I'm told to do. I'm a Muppet here.